Good morning, church! It's great that you're with us this morning. Wherever you're watching this, whether it's in the living room, in the bedroom, in the bathroom, in the shed, it's just great that you're with us. And if you're a visitor and this is your first time virtually with us in West Wickham and Shirley Baptist Church, you are especially welcome. It's great that you've joined us this morning. We've got lots planned. It's Palm Sunday today, and Stuart's going to help us reflect on that. And then we're going to also be looking at the story of Esther as well a bit later on as we continue to think about this time of national emergency and crisis. And talking about that, you know that as a church, we want to care for one another and also for our wider community as well of West Wickham and Shirley. And the way that we're doing that is through care packages, whether that's from basic essentials that you need or maybe some financial assistance. Please do check out our website, wwsbc.org.uk. There's a special form there you can fill out and we will help in any way that we can. Whether it's you who's actually watching this or there is someone that you know who is in need, we'd love to be there to assist them and to bless them at this time. Now we're moving into Holy Week this week and we've got a few things planned. So the first thing will be Maundy Thursday. Maundy Thursday at 4 p.m. we're going to be hosting a Zoom prayer meeting and all those details will be on our Facebook page and also on our WhatsApp page. And we'd love you to join us at 4 p.m. to pray together. And there'll be a special reflection as well as we start our Easter celebrations. And then on Good Friday itself, we are going to be hosting again a Zoom meeting at 10 a.m. And it's going to be a virtual communion service. So you're going to need to have ready for that service bread and wine, maybe even pork. Maybe Ribena, it's entirely up to you. But at 10 a.m. we're going to gather together virtually to celebrate and to think about Good Friday. If you don't think you're able to make it on Zoom or you don't really know how to work Zoom, then it'll also be available as a download on YouTube as well. It'll be recorded to watch later in the day. So at 10 a.m. virtual communion service on Zoom. As I say, all the details will be available on our Facebook page and on WhatsApp and on the website. And last, and of course not least, Easter Sunday itself. We will gather again next Sunday via YouTube to celebrate Easter Sunday, the day that Christ rose from the dead. So I hope you're able to join us over those Easter celebrations. Whatever you're doing through the course of this rest of this day and through this week, may God bless you and protect you. We are praying for you. We're here for you if you need us. So please don't hesitate to be in contact and keep in contact with one another. I really want to thank you for the way in which, as a church, we're continuing to be church, caring for each other. Keep it going, my brothers and my sisters. Let's jump into our service. Enjoy.
Good morning, everyone. I hope that you're all well. So, kids, today is a very special day. It's Palm Sunday, which means it's 1 week to Easter. Good times. But before we rush and get to Easter, let's take some time to think about what Palm Sunday is all about. I'm sure you guys know it really well. Palm Sunday is a day when Jesus rode on a donkey into Jerusalem and the crowds were cheering and welcoming him in. They couldn't wait to see what Jesus was going to do. They were excited to see what Jesus was about. And so they welcomed him. Now maybe the crowds sounded like this. I don't know. But there was a lot of excitement as Jesus rode in on his donkey. And that got me thinking, how can we welcome Jesus at the moment? What can we do to welcome Jesus? Well, I want to suggest three things. Number one, we can welcome Jesus when we think about the way that we treat each other. That means thinking about the words that we use and thinking about the things that we do. It means trying to treat people the way that we would like to be treated. Now that is not always easy, and in this time of the coronavirus, when we're stuck between four walls and we can't get away from our families, that can be hard because families can easily rub us up the wrong way and frustrate us. But it's at those times that we need to try really hard to be patient, to be generous with our words, to be gentle with our actions, and we need to try really hard to forgive when people are frustrating and annoying us. And when we do those things, that's welcoming Jesus, because we're trying to live the Jesus way. But it's not just about what goes on inside the four walls. It can include thinking about the way we treat people in our streets. There may be people in your street who need help with the shopping or with other things, specifically at the moment during the coronavirus. And when we think about what we say to them and how we can help them, things that we can do, the way we act, that's welcoming Jesus, because we're living the Jesus way. Number two, we welcome Jesus every time we think about and care for the people that normally get ignored and left out. In the scriptures, Jesus calls those people the least, the last, and the lost. Who are the people that you can think of that might fall into one of those categories? Being the least, or being the people at the bottom, the last people, or the people that are lost, that just don't feel like they belong. When we reach out to those people, when we try and find a way of including them, maybe with our words, or maybe through a kind gesture, maybe a phone call or a letter through the post, that's welcoming Jesus, because we're living the Jesus way again. We're thinking about how Jesus informs what we're doing in our lives. Number three, we welcome Jesus when we spend time with him. This is perhaps the most obvious one. We have a God who's with us all the time. I love the way the Apostle Paul puts it. Paul says, God is the one in whom we live and move and have our being. That sounds really complicated, but what it means is we are living in God right now. God isn't over there, somewhere else, coming in and out. We are in God. So the challenge for us is to be aware of where God is at work, to be aware of God's presence, because God's presence is all around us. And every time we make a decision to try and do that, we're welcoming Jesus. Now, maybe that might mean taking some time out just to be still for a little bit. We've done that in Bright Lights, haven't we? It might mean taking some time to talk to other people who maybe know Jesus a little bit better than you do. But when we do those things, we're welcoming Jesus, because we're trying to spend time with him. So Palm Sunday is so much more than just the thing that happens one week before Easter. It's a time when we can be reminded that we can welcome Jesus into our lives, just like the crowd welcomed Jesus as he rode into Jerusalem on the back of a donkey. So what can you do this week to welcome Jesus into your life? Boom!
Everyone needs compassion, love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of the Savior, the hope of nations. Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation, he rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Take me as you find me, all my fears and failures. Fill my life again. I give my life to follow everything I believe in. Now I surrender. Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation, Jesus conquered the grave. Lord, thank you that you are mighty to save, that you are our Saviour. Lord, we all need compassion right now, and I thank you that you are the God of all compassion, and that we can find compassion in you. So let's draw close to God right now, because he's there for us. Draw me close to you. Never let me go. Lay it all down again to hear you say that I'm your friend. You are my delight. No one else will do. Nothing else can take your place. To feel the warmth of your embrace. Help me find the way. Bring me back to you. Draw me close to you. Let me go. I lay it all down again to hear you say that I'm your friend. You are my delight. No one else will do. Nothing else can take your place. To feel the warmth of your embrace. Help me find the way. Bring me back to you. You're all. You're all I want. You're all I've ever needed. You're all I want. Help me know you are near. This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence living in me. This is my daily breath. This is my daily bread. Your very word. spoken to me, and I'm desperate for you. This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence living in me. This is my daily bread. This is my daily bread. Your very word spoken to me, and I'm desperate for you. Lord, we are truly lost without you, and yet we don't have to be without you. We're not without you. You are with us in this situation. And Lord, we give you thanks. We give you thanks for your compassion and for your presence. Help us day by day to draw close to you. In Jesus' name.
Good morning, my name is Sarah and I'm one of the ministers here at West Wickham and Shirley Baptist Church, and I've just returned from maternity leave. So a big hello to all of you who know me and all of you who don't. It's great to be back, and let's now pray together. Let's spend some time in prayer together. Let's come before God and be still in his presence. Thank you, Jesus, that you are with us. Thank you for the beauty of creation, for friends and family, although they're at a distance, and for love. And thank you for technology, which is keeping us all together at this time. We thank you, Jesus, for the hope that you bring. And above all, we thank you that we are loved by you. In this time where things are so different and difficult, where life has changed so completely, where there is fear and illness and death, we pray for your peace that passes all understanding. We pray for those who are working on the front line, quite literally risking their lives and their own safety to care for and help others. Thank you for the courage. Thank you for the courage of the NHS staff, for those who are stacking shelves every day, for those working in supermarkets, for the teachers still in schools, for the emergency services of all kinds. We thank you for them. We pray that you would give them strength, Lord Jesus. And we pray that you would lift them when they are struggling. We pray particularly for those in our own fellowship who are on the front line. And we just name them before you now. Lord, we pray you would be their strength today. And we thank you for them. For those who are sick, for those who are lonely or isolated, we pray that you would be their healing, that you would be their comfort. Right now, Lord, we pray they would know that you are right by their side, that they would know that you will never leave them, and that nothing can separate them from your love. We pause to remember and pray for those in our hearts who are isolated, sick, or lonely at this time. And we pray for parents who are homeschooling, juggling being a teacher, maybe trying to do their own work, and being a parent. Give them patience and wisdom. Help them to know what an incredible job they are doing. And we pray for the children, Lord, whose lives have changed so completely. No more school, no more exams. Lord, we pray that you would be with them and help them as this is such a difficult time for them as well. We pray that they would know your love for them. And we pray that as a church, you would help us to love and look after one another, to think of our neighbours and those in our community, and to help us to be a shining light for you in this dark time. Thank you, Jesus, that you are with us through it all, and help us to recognise your presence each day. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Enjoy the rest of the service.
Good morning, church. I hope God is taking good care of you in these challenging times. Our reading today is taken from St. Paul's letter to the Romans, chapter 8, verse 18, right down to verse 28. For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. For the earnest expectation of the creation eagerly waits for the revealing of the sons of God. For the creation was subjected to futility, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it in hope. Because the creation itself will be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God. For we know that the whole creation groans and labors with birth pangs together until now. Not only that, but we also who have the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves groan within ourselves, eagerly waiting for adoption, the redemption of our body.
Verse 24, for we were saved in this hope, but hope that is seen is not hope. For why does one still hope for what he sees? But if we hope for what we do not see, we eagerly wait for it with perseverance. Likewise, the Spirit also helps in our weaknesses. For we do not know what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit himself makes intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. Now he who searches the hearts knows what the mind of the Spirit is, because he makes intercession for the saints according to the will of God. And we know that all things work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose. This is the word of the Lord.
Amen.
What do you do in a crisis? Now, I've never really had to think about that question, never had a need to think through what I would do if there was a national emergency until, well, we find ourselves in a national emergency. You know, something has got to a crisis point when history itself is being redefined and altered. Like the trend at the moment to change BC before Christ and AD anidonomai. BC has become before coronavirus and AD after distancing. Now, we don't know what AD will look like or when it's going to occur. And we're just looking to God for his enduring presence, his wisdom, his guidance as we journey into this yet unknown future. And it's because of this unknown future, it leads to a sense of crisis, a sense that everything is shaking beneath our feet. Now, I'm certain a lot of us have been giving thought to the not so light side of life over the past couple of weeks. It might be that we've been sifting through our wills, or maybe we've even considered making a will where we've never thought of that before. Or maybe we've started talking to our family and our loved ones about end of life care and what we would want in the event of us being in that position. So many of us are afraid of death that we don't even utter the word itself. But it's okay. It's healthy to have those conversations now. Better now rather than later. They're good conversations to be taking place. Maybe some of us have found ourselves doing an inventory of things around the house or in our cupboards. I did that. I did a rifle through all of our kitchen cupboards to see what we had. And when I opened one of the drawers, I found herbs and spices that were older than my daughter's. In fact, I'm fairly certain that the jar of sage has moved house with us, not once, but probably twice in the last 15 years. And of course, I found right at the very back, one of those jars of spices, chili powder from India. Woo! Knock your socks off power it had. And I remember that having an effect, not just the next day, but several days after, if you know what I mean. What do you do in a crisis? In truth, I found a mixture of responses. Panic, bewilderment, complete calm, and fear. Sometimes even a mix of all of these in a single moment. There's a great book in the Old Testament. It's called Esther. And it's a story about a Jewish girl who becomes the queen of Persia. It's a story fraught with danger and espionage. The villain of the tale is the Prime Minister, not Boris Johnson, rather a man called Haman. And he's a man who is intent on wiping the Jewish people completely out. Through a series of what looks like coincidences, but what we see in the wider scope of things is actually God's hand at work, his divine providence. Esther finds herself in a 400 BC equivalent of Miss World contest, a beauty contest, which she wins to become the Queen of Persia. Alongside her cousin, a guy called Mordecai, who is like her guardian angel, they work together to save the Jewish people from Haman, who are constantly under threat time and time again from his wicked ways and for his scheming for the Persian king, King Xerxes. The crisis comes to a head when Esther goes to see the king. She needs to tell him what Haman is plotting. She needs the king to intervene for her and for her people. You know, this has been immortalized in artwork throughout the centuries, particularly in European artwork. Esther's all dolled up very often in these pictures, and she enters into the palace. And out of sheer fear, in many of these pictures, she's seen swooning or fainting. Now, you won't find this description in our Bibles, but you will find it in the Catholic Bible or the Orthodox Bible. And truthfully, I think it makes a lot of sense. Esther would have been absolutely terrified of going to see the king. You know, in the artwork, she looks like she's going on a special date, when actually she's pleading for her life and for the life of her people. This is crisis time. She may have the title of queen, but in reality, Esther is just a slave. The last queen had so displeased the king that she had been banished from the kingdom. This episode right here, as she swoons in front of the king, is the very center of the story. It's a decisive moment found in Esther chapter 5. You know, in every crisis or in times of crisis, there is always a decisive moment, a time when we have to face what we fear the most. And this is Esther's moment. She's ready. She's beautiful. She's clothed in splendor. But this is not a Romeo and Juliet moment. It's not a Ross and Rachel moment. It is fraught with danger. It's more like an Anne Frank moment. You know, Anne Frank was a Jewish teenager in Amsterdam during the occupation. You probably know the story really well. She and her family hid out in an apartment, unable to leave the house, hiding from the Gestapo behind fake walls, trapped inside. Feel familiar? She writes in her diary these words. Today, the sun is shining. The sky is a deep blue. There is a lovely breeze, and I am longing, so longing for everything, for freedom, for friends, not to be alone. And I do so long to cry. I feel as if I'm going to burst. And I know that it would get better with crying, but I can't. I'm restless. I go from room to room, breathe through the cracks of a closed window, feel my heart beating as if it is saying, can't you satisfy my longing at last? I believe that it is spring within me. I feel that spring is awakening. I feel it in my whole body and soul. It's an effort to behave normally. I feel utterly confused. I don't know what to read, what to write, what to do. I only know that I am longing. That's Esther. Longing. Longing to be free from her slavery. Longing for peace. Longing for this crisis to end. Feel familiar? You know, if you read the story of Esther, you'll see time and time again that God is at work, that things are happening, things are coming together at just the right time. And sometimes, as you read the story of Esther, you want to scream out to her and say, hold on, keep going, be brave, Esther. God is at work, even if you can't see it now. And so here in chapter 5, Esther walks in to the throne room. What's the reception going to be like? The king sees her and is captivated. So much so that he holds out his scepter and he declares, and what's your desire, Queen Esther? What do you want? Ask and it's yours, even if it's half of my kingdom. That is quite an offer. Xerxes is offering half of the kingdom of Persia. Enormous amount of wealth, and he most definitely doesn't mean it. Ladies, you know this to be true. Men never mean it, do they? The bigger the offer, the smaller the chance. Xerxes didn't mean it. But nonetheless, Esther had her chance. She had now the ear of the king. And so what would she do? She asks him to dinner. She extends the invitation to her enemy, Haman, and asks them to dinner. What is she doing? You know, I can imagine her cousin, Mordecai, stage left, throwing his hands in the air and saying, oh, Esther, you've just missed an open goal. And you've said yourself for such a time as this, what are you doing? But Esther doesn't want to be seen here as the aggressor. She wants Haman to hang himself out to dry. She trusts that God will vindicate her, that he will come to the rescue of his people, and he will save them from annihilation. For God had made the promise to always be with his people. And here we are today. Not just a nation, but a world facing a crisis that has the potential for so much destruction. And we may feel like God is missing in action, that somehow God is not at work in the crisis we face today. Esther patiently waited for Haman to implicate himself, to show what kind of a man he was. And eventually that happens. Haman tricks King Xerxes into having all the Jews murdered, to sign a decree to wipe them all out. But he doesn't tell the king that that would include Esther, his queen. Now, when Esther tells the story at the dinner table, which Haman really loved to be invited to, as she unfolds the story and points the finger at Haman, Xerxes becomes furious and justice is served. Haman and his threat of annihilation is dealt the final blow, and Haman is taken away and is hung. Esther, for such a time as this, trusting in God, trusting that he was at work, even when she couldn't see it, trusting in his timing for such a time as this. And to celebrate the new freedom from tyranny, Mordecai called all of the Jewish people across Persia to a feast called Purim. And wow, what a feast it was. What a day of celebration. In fact, not one day, but 2 days. And it's a feast that the Jewish nation still celebrates today. It's a feast that reminds us that God is good, that God is always at work, even in the unseen. God is always working for our benefit, for the ones he loves. And who does he love? All of us. We're all loved by God, no matter what nation or creed we come from. Of course, for us, having now seen the New Testament unfold and the story of Jesus, which includes the horror of the cross, that there on the cross, Jesus suffers and dies, not alone, but between 2 others. That Jesus suffers with us. That God isn't distant and far off. He's not absent from what's happening in our world. He is among us, working for our good. That journey on that first Palm Sunday towards the cross reminds us that God is with us, that God is prepared to suffer with us. But Easter Sunday is an empty grave that shows that God is able, even in the unseen, even in the threat of death and destruction, there is hope of resurrection, of new life, even from death. It's the hope that love wins, the hope that love can bring about new life, even from death. Yes, we are in a crisis. And we can face this crisis with a sinking fear, or we can face this crisis knowing that God is at work for our good. And as Romans said to us earlier, nothing can separate us from the love of God. That perfect love casts out fear. So let's be like Esther. Let's trust in God. Let's face the crisis head on. Let's be the church. Let's be the people for such a time as this, trusting that God is working even in the unseen. Friends, let's pray. Father God, I pray for each and every one of us as we watch this video, that we would have a deep sense that you are with us and that you love us and that your love will ultimately win. Lord, right now in the midst of this crisis, we may feel bewildered. We may feel panic. We may feel worried about ourselves, our health, about our loved ones, our wider family. We may feel worried about our financial situation. We hold all of that before you, trusting that you're the God who is for us and not against us. And we pray that you might be at work now, at work in the lives of those who are able to most affect change in the government, scientists, health professionals. We pray, Lord, that in each of those circumstances and situations, you might bring wisdom and understanding, and that, Lord, we might see and find ways through this crisis that may even bring about blessing and genuine change for us around the world. Lord, I pray now that you might protect us and watch over us. And Lord, put that deep sense of trust and faith in you. And may we be a people for such a time as this, a people of faith and trust in the God who is at work. In Jesus' name. Amen. Maybe you've been watching this video and you're not Christian. And you don't know and understand that God is at work. In fact, you feel like God has abandoned us. That if there is a God, then he's distant and far off. Why would he allow such a thing to happen? As I said a bit earlier, God loves you. His love for you sent his one and only son, Jesus. Jesus died on a cross, as I say, not alone, but between two others who suffered and died. He came to identify with our suffering. He's with us. It breaks God's heart to see such suffering in our world. It was never his intention. It was never his design. But he came to show us the way of love, to show us the way, a different way of living. In fact, he showed that by loving the least, the last, and the lost. Jesus was always there with those who were on the outside that they may be brought in. He was never with the power brokers. He was always with the least able. And God wants to be with you too. In this moment of crisis, he wants you to experience the height, the width, and the depth of his love for you. And the most amazing thing is, the Christian faith believes that God didn't just die, but he rose from the dead. That Jesus went through death and has come up through the other side. That's what Easter Sunday is all about. And that truth means that we have hope even beyond death itself. You could say it's a crutch. Actually, I think I might need a crutch in these days that we have. Some help to get through. I don't mind that. And maybe right now, you need something to lean on. You need a truth that you can believe in. You need an anchor in your soul. Why don't you simply invite Jesus Christ into your life today and know that he comes with love and compassion for you? Why don't you pray with me now? Lord Jesus Christ, I invite you into my life. In these days, I need something to lean on. I need something beyond what I can see, a truth that I can place my life firmly upon. I feel like I'm sinking. Would you place my feet upon a rock? Lord Jesus, I pray that you would reveal yourself to me. Come and fill my life with your love, I pray. Help me to know that you are at work in this situation, even if I can't see it. Help me to have faith in you, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen. If you prayed that simple prayer, then we would love to be able to help you in this journey of faith. Why don't you contact us at office@wwsbc.org.uk or connect with us on Facebook, facebook.com/WWSBC. Or why don't you go to our website, wwsbc.org.uk, and we'd love to get in contact with you because we've got lots of resources to help you in this journey that you're starting today. For all of us that are watching this video, God bless you this week in all that you do. We are praying for your protection. We're praying for God's provision for you as families and as friends of this church. And if there is anything that we can help you with over the course of this week, don't hesitate to get in contact and make sure that you're in contact through our WhatsApp group, WWSBC. God bless you. May the Lord richly guide you and provide for you this week. And we'll see you soon.